I'm Lynette Francis, and I'll be facilitating this part of the conversation. As you can see, I've wanted to ensure that the presenters are comfortable, and they don't want it to be too formalized. They want it to be a conversation, which I'm also very comfortable with. And the idea is that we engage with one another. When Dr. Titus asked me if I'd be interested in being a part of this discussion, I jumped at the opportunity, because every week I have the privilege to be in conversation with millions of South Africans across South Africa on television, on radio, and also in my weekly blog. And I must say, I say privilege because I have the honor of eavesdropping, of intruding, of stirring the difficult, the uncomfortable, the not so politically correct conversations on a national and a local level. And I get to tap into the national consciousness and the conscience, but also the conversations that people are having with one another that they don't necessarily feel comfortable enough to share with others because it might reflect too much on where they're at or what they think about. Yesterday, for example, we spoke about the road to reconciliation between victims and the community of Worcester, affected by the Worcester bomb attack in 1996. And it was quite interesting to see how the victims engaged with their process to reconciliation, and also their approach and attitude and concerns and feelings, very emotive, about the perpetrator, Stephanus Kutsia, and how they struggle to understand what it is that they feel, the obligation some of them say to have healed, because after all, it's how many years later, and a lot of them that are still not there. People who are very explicit in saying, I cannot forgive, people who are saying, I hate, people who are saying, nothing has changed, people who are disillusioned. And that's why I'm so glad that we're having this opportunity to talk about how we've changed in South Africa or not. And as a journalist, I've had the opportunity and the privilege to share my South African experience as a journalist, not only in South Africa, but abroad. And one particular conversation, and I was so appreciative of your comments earlier before the break, because those were the kind of things that came up in discussions that I was a part of in Burundi a few years ago, where the Institute of Justice and Reconciliation was working together with the United Nations to talk about reconciliation, particularly after what was happening in Rwanda and Burundi, etc. And soon after that, a few years later, I was also involved with a conversation between Jews and Palestinians in Ramallah. And one thing that stood out for me was one gentleman that said, and I want to quote him here this morning, he very politely told me that reconciliation and our rainbow nation in South Africa is a farce. And I have to tell you, that hurt. Because besides the fact that it hurt, it touched a nerve. Because what am I doing as a journalist, as a boulder, as someone that's supposed to engage with South African society in other countries, telling them what we've supposedly learned in South Africa, and we're still struggling with and grappling with these issues. So I hope that in this session, we're able to, after our speaker's presentation, that you interrogate the things that they say, that we engage and have a conversation, the uncomfortable silences, the invisible things that we don't want to touch on, that we'll take the opportunity to do that. And in this session, we'll be discussing the national picture of diversity in South Africa. The speakers have asked me to allow them to present to you, and then we'll just continue the conversation. I'll pick up on that. And on my far left, Professor Julian Son, will give his impressions of how he experiences through his workshops and his facilitation of what the national picture looks like when we start talking, if at all, about diversity. Professor Son?
Thank you, Lynette. I want to start off just by thanking all of you for coming. I think having these type of conversations about these topics is a very important part of nation building. So thanks for coming. And then thank you, Lynette, for the work you're doing nationally, raising these type of concerns and the manner in which you do it. And then also, Danny, thanks for the role you've played in organizing this, but also the leadership role that you play in the country. also to keep conversations between people alive. And then both Nene Molefi and I guess we've competed for a lot of contracts. But I appreciate the work you're doing, because I think it's important that we celebrate each other and also support each other and get away from working in a competitive way. And in a way that's not celebrating the diversity, that the way we work together, we also need to celebrate the diversity. I'm also really fortunate to share the platform with Melissa. Melissa and I have worked together. I think you were in the first workshop we did here. In 1990, when I came back to South Africa, we did a workshop at UCT at the Center for Conflict Resolution, and Melissa was a part. I realized you didn't quite know which group to go to.
You still remember?
So I told her, go with the white people, what's your problem? Which brings me to an interesting topic about identity. You know that identity is how we identify ourselves, but identity is also how other people identify us and how other people see us. So sometimes we would say, like Iron did a while ago, I'm a so-called colored. But then folks, particularly in Gauteng, will look at me and say, that so-called colored is saying, no, that colored is saying he's a so-called colored. So we also need to bear in mind, you know, how is it that people see us. Melissa wrote a great book, White is Not What It Used to Be. I just had a workshop on Saturday where I used sections of that book. It was mostly a white group. And I think it's an essential read, because it deals with the whole issue of how we have created these different identities and the whole process of renaming ourselves, I think, is very much part of what we are engaging in South Africa at present. For example, she makes a comment in her book, we're in a stage of gappiness. It's sort of, we are now busy finding ways of describing ourselves. Like, I think so-called colored is sort of part of that. Some folks say I'm colored, other folks would say I'm South African, other folks would say I'm African, some folks would say I'm black. And I find in all communities there's that process now of redefinition, which I think is a very useful and important process as we engage in this conversation about who are we as a South African nation. At Stellenbosch University, the Vice Chancellor, Russell Botma, just initiated that conversation, that we speak about the South African identity. And I really enjoy that, because I think the whole question of speaking about our multiple identities and the shifting nature of those identities is an important one. I was on TV this morning, with the leader of the Afrikaner Bond. And, you know, afterwards we spoke about, is that still a useful identity to have as we build a nation? The first point I want to say, first celebrating all the leaders working in the field, and then celebrating the quality of leaders we've had in South Africa. It was a pleasure to listen to you, Dr. Bam, because you are also one of the national leaders who played a significant role in getting all of us to exercise the vote and educating ourselves around that. I think we are very fortunate that we had a quality of a leader like Nelson Mandela. And I think one of the issues around diversity and nation building is to speak about a leader like Nelson Mandela and to say, what are those values? What are those qualities that we now need to internalize and make part of our nation? And I think one of the dominant things was his genuine commitment to reconciliation. And in the relatively short period of time that he was a president, how he went out of his way to really extend himself to all South Africans. Because I think that's a major challenge for us. In South Africa, we still have a tendency to define ourselves narrowly. Like with this workshop over the weekend, it was mostly English-speaking South Africans. And we asked them this question, how do you identify culturally? And it was interesting how narrow their definition was. And I thought that poses a problem as we are creating a more inclusive society. So we still have a tendency to identify a sense of community narrowly, and then also not to literally open our hearts to everybody. I was teasing this guy afterwards. I told him, it would be now weird if I'm a professor at a university and I say I'm only concerned about the colored students. I mean, that'll be sort of absurd. So I think the way we really open ourselves to all South Africans in our daily lives and literally open our hearts is an important challenge as we engage in this nation-building process. You know, I'm a big fan of Bob Marley, and I love that song of his One Love. Love is indivisible. If you love, you love. I can't just love you and sort of block myself from opening up to others. And I think we're fortunate that we live in a country where this notion of Ubuntu continues to be the dominant prevailing way we are with each other. And I sometimes have the feeling that in the Afrikaans community there's also a sense of, and I must, when I speak about the Afrikaans community, I also want to acknowledge there's a lot of changes going on in that community as well. And it's not a homogeneous community. But I think sometimes there's a tendency there, like now with this Afrikaner Belange mentality, of defining the community very narrowly. And I think a major challenge for us is really to open up in how we define ourselves and then how we engage in others. I also think we really need to celebrate our constitution, just the quality of the document and what a good framework it is for us to work together. And I think a major challenge in the whole area of diversity now is to really unpack the values of the constitution, encourage people to recite the preamble. Folks sometimes choke up when they read that preamble. I mean, it's a very moving and touching document. And I think it'll be useful if we institute it in our schools, which is another topic that I want to just touch on. Iron spoke about citizenship. And Mampela Rampela started that citizen movement. And I think that is an important way of dealing with the issue of diversity now, is for us really to work on talking about what does it mean to be a citizen? What are our responsibilities? What are our accountabilities? Because the South Africans, as Mampela often indicates, we're used to being subjects. And I think, unfortunately, a lot of the policies like grant giving, I think, is necessary. And it tends to continue to foster a sense of dependency, this notion that the government must do for me. So I think another challenge for us is to talk about citizenship and mostly for all of us to assume 100% responsibility. Some themes that I just want to mention and that I hope we can talk more about is the whole issue of history. And history more defined as all our stories. It's my sense that all of us have useful and important stories, and that we need to engage in the process of looking for opportunities to tell our stories, to write about our stories, because our stories is part of this process of creating a nation. And that, some people in the audience like Lizette and I do a lot of workshops together, and we're very fortunate that we can get people to tell some of their stories. And what we find is in telling our stories, we literally bring about personal change. Like if I have an opportunity to listen to your story, often in that engagement, I change my attitude about folks like you and folks who come from your particular background. So storytelling, I think it's a powerful tool and also a necessary strategy that we can use at an ongoing basis, and not to feel that your story is insignificant. Part of diversity is really to acknowledge all our similarities and all our differences, and therefore to acknowledge that your particular set of experiences you need to share with others. And Yeah, I'm often touched with most of the African students, the African black students who come to USB, come from very, very poor backgrounds. And I always encourage them to talk about that because I think it's so much to their credit and to the credit of those communities they come from that they are now mining engineers. Incidentally, many of them studied at UJ to become mining engineers, for example. And so they're in all these top positions, although they had all those obstacles to overcome. And we need to know those stories. Otherwise, it's difficult really to value their resilience, their determination, their ability to achieve in spite of the backgrounds that they've had. So storytelling is a key issue. I think another theme that we need to also talk about more is culture. Iron sort of briefly spoke about the culture of UJ, how they are at UJ. And I think all of us need to think about and talk about what are these ways that we would characterize ourselves. At Stellenbosch University, the Vice Chancellor took the initiative and started creating committees where one of the committees was to speak about how do we create a welcoming culture. And that was a useful strategy and an important conversation because those of us on the committee realized you can't speak about a welcoming culture without speaking about the whole culture. And that conversation is continuing. He also put together a committee to talk about Vision 2030. And that was also useful because that's also defining what it is we want to be at the university, but also making sure we as a university is aligned to the national vision. And I still find the national vision, the notion of a non-sexist, non-racist, inclusive constitutional democracy, a very useful one. Which brings me to the last point. In creating a non-sexist and non-racist and inclusive democracy, we really need to talk about all those elements. Like all of us need to be clear, what is racism? What was it historically? What's old-fashioned racism? What's modern racism? And ask ourselves the question, how did it affect me? Because my sense is racism, not unlike sexism and classism, it's sort of like the air we breathe and the air is polluted. You can't not breathe it. If all our leaders before 94 were white men, just by them being in those leadership positions influenced us. And many of us grew up in communities where there were no black or one or two doctors, but in the community I grew up in Queenstown, at that time there were no black lawyers, no black architects. So I picked up that message that black people become preachers and teachers, and that's of course also what we usually aspire to and what we sometimes were limited to become. Then, you know, Melissa's also an expert in communication. Organizations are really about our identities, it's about our communication, and it's about the relationships we build. So also to pay attention and use these type of opportunities to talk to each other and communicate with each other. And when we're in leadership positions, constantly talk about the values, about the vision, about the mission of that organization. And then I think with relationships, it's my sense in South Africa, it's developing trusting relationships that's often a challenge for us because we don't really have a basis of trust across these narrow areas that we were limited to. And therefore to understand what does it take to develop trust? And you know, they often say it takes time to develop trust, but you could break it very easily. And some of the things that's related to trust is being consistent, that we, you know, what we say is what we do. It's also to talk about our values and encourage people to hold us to those values, so to be consistent in that way. It also means compassionate, really genuinely cultivating a sense of compassion for the people you engage in. If you have a sense that I don't care about you, you shouldn't trust me, right? If I don't care about you, you better be cautious and be defensive. So trust can only sort of develop if there's a sense of compassion. There's these guys who does a lot of work in positive psychology, and I really love their work. And they say three things. One, compassion, opening your heart. And a funny thing is this, you know, I speak to the students about this, and in talking to the students about it, I then find I develop compassion for them, and they to me, just the way I speak about the importance of opening my heart as I engage with them. The second one is forgiveness, which is part of reconciliation, that we forgive in order to be free to engage with people. And bear in mind, if we hold grudges, we suffer as a result of the grudge we hold. So, you know, on the flip side, Dr. Bam, you spoke about the doubt we have. I think sometimes as South Africans, because of this message we got that we're not good enough, we've also internalized that message. And we sometimes doubt ourselves. You know, Steve Biko spoke about if you can oppress someone's, if you can influence someone's thinking and the way they feel about themselves, then you really have them where you want them. So I think we need to talk more about the ways we doubt ourselves and the ways we don't always have confidence and pay attention to those environments that sometimes does not give us that confidence and address those factors in those environments. And also pay attention to the environments where we feel confident. And then to take note of that and to appreciate the people and the environment for creating those things that's enhancing our confidence. But I think as a nation and part of our nation building project, it's essential that we really make peace with any types of doubts we have and that we realize, like, for example, speaking in public, the way you get better at this is by doing it. And with a lot of other things in life, we need to do it and have the confidence that we can do it. And as we do it, we'll become better at it.
I'm sure some of you are making notes. I'm making notes. I just want to allow the speakers to put it all out there, and then we can try and find the golden thread and ask some more questions. Melissa, is it so difficult to be white these days?
No, not at all, but some people make it. Okay, so well, let me just echo what Julian has said to say thank you to the organizers for this opportunity to speak here. And I also want to acknowledge Julian and the influence that he has had on my own life and career, but particularly my life, through the work that he's done, and in particular that very seminal workshop, which I continue to draw on to this day, in terms of how it's shaped my thinking and shaped the way in which I've understood the issues in South Africa. So, you know, Julian, that's a big debt. So also, just to say that I think this is a very timely gathering for us to sort of put our minds to what we could call a diversity audit. And as the organizers framed it for us is, you know, how far have we come and where do we need to go? And to sort of like put our minds into that frame and asking those questions. So, of course, the question did make me cast my mind back to the early 90s, about the time when Julian did that workshop. And my memory of the texture, the sort of the feel of those years, and the memory that is strongest for me is the sense of urgency that there was around the issues of diversity, of transformation, of change, and a huge amount of work in those days on conflict resolution. Which somehow I think has dissipated. And I think that's an important thing for us to sort of just reflect on for a moment, because there was a sense, having come through the history that we had in the sort of run-up to the 1990s, that this stuff is really serious. And if we get it wrong, it can push us right over the edge. And we had that experience, we all knew it in our bones that this stuff really, really, really mattered. And I think the most noticeable change that has happened, as I sense it, over the last 20 years, is this change in the ethos, that somehow that energy has dissipated, that sense of how this stuff really is important, and that we must get it right. That feeling has dissipated. And I know we can, to some extent ascribe it to the dominance of what everybody's theorizing about neoliberalism and, you know, consumer capitalism and individualism. And I think that there's a lot of truth in that, that we have, as our society has become more what they would call a normal society, we've been caught up in all the stuff. And one picks it up very strongly when you work with young people at university, that in many ways their priorities have shifted from a kind of a social consciousness to individual ambitions that are a lot tied up in terms of material progress. And I'm not saying that this is, I don't mean this as sort of like to denigrate the youth, because I think this, you know, it's understandable in terms of the way things are unfolding and where their lives are and the particular pressures that they're experiencing. But I think that this is true, that this has happened. Having said all that, I think that it's also true that in terms of these questions of transformation, in terms of the questions of diversity, there is a slow tide, that whether we're working very hard at it or not, that is sort of moving us along. You know, and I think just recently I was interviewed by a person who, well, a white man who'd left the country in about 1992. And I was just really struck by how he was like a playback from way back. You know, the sort of like the way in which he seemed to be configuring South Africa and South African issues seemed to completely, it's like, you know, like he just didn't know where we were at. So in some ways, I think that it's true that the years that we've been in a democracy, building our nation, we all have been moving together in some sort of way. But I think that unfortunately one could characterize the again, to sort of talk about the texture of where we're at now, is that we've been learning ways of being together separately. And I think a lot of the statistics will bear that out. That and that also is an achievement of sorts. I mean, I'm not going to completely knock that, because I mean we couldn't do that before. So let's not, you know. And there are many places in the world that aren't able to do that. So I think that it is something that we must recognize as not being an unqualified sort of like a failure to do the work that we need to do. But having said that, I think it's disappointing, and I think it's not enough. And I think that if we don't do more, it's going to come back to bite us. And so I think that we do need to, if we're doing an audit, we need to take stock of the fact that we have come somewhere, but we have not done a lot of the really hard work that we need to be doing as a nation. And I think that certainly when it comes to actively taking on the challenges of diversity within our society, a lot of the overt resistance, not all of it, we know that there are definitely, you know, pockets of strong overt resistance, but most of that overt resistance is largely given way into somewhat more muted attitudes that I would sort of like describe as a kind of a nonchalance about the issues. That the, you know, with the dissipation of the energy, it's like it just doesn't really matter all that terribly much. And I think we can see this in our EE figures, in the employment equity figures, which in some ways are stagnating, in some ways actually moving backwards. That we're actually seeing employment equity slipping, because people just don't feel that it's really all that urgent to do this anymore. Like, we're actually doing okay, and we, you know, nobody's doing anything about it, and it's not going to actually, there's no consequences if we don't actually address ourselves to these issues, and so we can sort of just, you know, let it go. I think what is scary about that is that in some ways, I mean, you know, when people talk about diversity, particularly in the context of things like employment equity, they usually put compliance as sort of like the lowest level of engagement with diversity, you know, sort of like if you're only just being driven by the legal system and you're only just doing what you have to in order to be able to get the figures right for government, that's the lowest level of compliance. But what I think the figures are beginning to show us is that in some ways we're not even there anymore. That the, even compliance is not really sort of like driving us as strongly as it used to. So I think that part of understanding this is to recognize that the struggle that we were engaged in prior to 1994 has in some way settled into these spaces like this, you know, nice carpeted rooms, you know, beautiful buildings, organizational settings, institutional settings. That's where the struggle is now. And it's really around, you know, who gets to control discourses, the ways in which we understand things, who gets into positions of power, who gets into positions of being able to make the decisions. And to a large extent, that's where the struggle is now. It's around, there's where we're negotiating the power that previously was being negotiated through throwing stones and throwing bombs and you know, sort of like the really strong, violent protest and offensives that were challenging the then power structures. I thought I'd just want to mention to you some research that we did when I was still at UCT, when the center was still down at UCT. We did some research into organizations in different sectors. So we tried to do sort of like one organization from a whole number of different sectors across the country. We initially wanted to do what the company itself regarded as a successful diversity intervention. And the intention was that we would try to understand what had really worked and how then could we use this to formulate, you know, processes and procedures that would be helpful, you know, to tell other people this is what's working in organizations. It turned out to be extremely difficult to get organizations to let us come in and do research. There was a huge amount of defensiveness, which in itself tells a story. In fact, we felt that if we'd recorded all the reasons, I mean, I would call them excuses that companies gave for not letting us have a look at what's working in their organizations, that in itself would have been a really interesting article. Unfortunately, these are the things you only know afterwards, you know. But another one of the intentions was that we argued that in doing sort of like diversity interventions, most of us are working with models that are developed in the North, with processes that are developed in the North, and because our transformation is of a completely qualitatively different kind. In places like America, diversity interventions are understood, or the whole process of intervening into dominant power structures is understood as bringing in representative numbers of marginalized groups. It's not understood to be that there's a radical revolutionary change that needs to happen within organizations. Nobody's arguing that. Whereas, obviously, in our context, it's not just margins coming into the center, but we're trying to shift the whole sort of framework of our society so that people, the majority who were previously marginalized, move into the centered positions. This is surely what we're trying to do in our country. So this was also partly what we wanted to look at, is how could we help help the conversation towards achieving that. So what I really want to tell you is that the results of that took a little while for me to actually really understand what it was that we were seeing. Partly, I suppose, because I really didn't want to understand it. But what emerged was actually that our organizations still really look like North American organizations. And so much of our power structures still actually are like that. That actually, it's not inappropriate that we're using, well, let me reframe that and say that it's not surprising that we're still using those models, and maybe that is part of the problem. But in reality, the people who are still holding the centered positions in our society are still actually there. And the power structures, we're actually still, in terms of the way in which we work with changing organizations, we're still actually working with power relations that allow us only to see it as bringing in certain numbers of people from the margins. We're still working with that. And I mean, I found that sort of like quite a wake-up call. That in fact we still have the gatekeepers who are holding our transformation at that kind of level. And letting people in, there's still questions of, you know, how many people should we let in? You know, who should we let in from amongst those people, and on what terms should we let them in, and how can we let them in so that they don't actually really rock the boat in any kind of way? So that we're still actually working with that. Those are still the dynamics that I think are operating quite strongly in many, if not most, by far. So as I say, I mean, it could be that we're still actually working with the wrong models, and I think we do still need to think that through. But for me, it's very clear that the power relations in most of our organizational settings, and this would apply also for like the media, I must say, you know, those organizations that are responsible for, in many ways, setting the agendas and the terms of the discourses and the discussions that shape our sense of the understanding of where our society is at. For me, it's clear that those power relations have obviously been somewhat troubled by the advent of democracy, but not profoundly so. And that in reality, the whole process of change it's been possible to hold it somewhat at bay and to contain it in these ways. And a major aspect of that, and I think this links very closely with what Julian has said, is that our subjectivities, the actual way in which we understand our sense of self within the sort of broader understandings of our society and the way in which we are positioned relative to each other, has not changed very much. It's actually, I think, in some ways hardly changed. In critical race theory, there's this notion of interest convergence, which I find, and it speaks to me about where we're at. And basically what that concept suggests is that dominant groups will accommodate and include and change to sort of like bring in enough of subordinated groups' interests that they don't actually really have to change profoundly. So that there's that way the interests, so that the interests of the dominant groups can actually be sustained, even though, you know, there is a sense of something having shifted. You know, so I think that's to me is a useful way of understanding where we're at in terms of change and particularly in relation to issues of diversity. And I think in this respect, it's important for us to then get a grip on, in thinking of interest convergence, how the racialized, the gendered, the sexualized, and the ableized, I don't know if that's a word, but it seems to work in this context, these subjectivities which are shaped, and importantly, I think, shaped at the intersections of unequal power relations, and we have to hold that right at the center of our analysis. These subjectivities that are shaped through these sort of complex interactions of these different hegemonic systems still leave certain patterns of entitlement. You know, the interest convergence means that those certain patterns of entitlement are able to perpetuate themselves. And work through who is able to set their positionality, their subjectivity, their way of doing things, their ways of, Julian mentioned culture, their ways of setting the terms of the culture, to keep those as the norm and to keep them centered. And as I say, I mean, I don't think that those have really been reframed in the way that they need to be if we want deep transformation in our society. So it's about who this a sense of who are the appropriate people, whose positionality is the appropriate positionality for their views to dominate in discourse, for their interests to be most noticed, most talked about, most thought about in society, for them to be in the dominating positions within most organizations, and indeed for them to be wealthy, you know, for them to accrue resources and for it to seem normal that those resources should be in their hands. You know, I mean, the sort of conversations that we have about poor white Afrikaners, for example, and I mean, I don't think anybody should be poor. We should be working with our resources in such a way that everybody is held properly in our society. But at the same time, it's a good example, I think, of how this sort of centered subjectivity operates in society, because it's like it's an outrage. It's terrible and awful and a complete disgrace that there are, I don't know what, 50,000? I don't know what the figure is, so forgive me, but, you know, poor white people. Like, we're all shocked about this and like it needs to be remedied, and there's a lot of writing about it, when it seems just, you know, just completely normal that, you know, 30 million black people should be completely almost like destitute in our society, and that's just seemed to be the way, you know, well, that's the way it is, you know. So that's an example of that centering, you know, like whose issues are put on the center stage, and who, you know, whose views about those issues are seen to be the ones that actually that society truly, truly takes seriously, and who's able to make the sort of presence of other people in the spaces that they have completely controlled before seem to be sort of illegitimate in some way, or like they're there by the good graces of the magnanimity of the dominant group for letting people into their organizations or into their spaces or whatever, or else that it's sort of like an illegitimate pressure that's being driven by an unreasonable government. You know, that those sort of feelings about people who've been excluded before moving into these spaces. So as part of this, I also then just want to address myself to the question that I think the sort of dominating view around diversity issues, particularly within organizations, it's driven also by our employment equity legislations. There's this view that you know, the way to change the spaces where we work together, for example, is that we need to just bring in sort of a certain number of people from, as I said, from marginalized positions. And then, you know, to sort of questions of like our subjectivities, which we've been talking about, the questions of the deep ways in which we understand ourselves in relation to other people, that is sort of like an additional luxury. It's an extra that we can do, you know, once we've got the numbers right, if we want to, and it's like not really a particularly, that we aren't driven by the need to do this kind of deep transformational work. And the paradox is, and then we see it, the paradox is that if you don't do that deep transformational work, you don't even get the numbers right. So it doesn't help to sort of think of it as just like a two-step process, and that the deeper work is something that can wait, because we see that we don't get the numbers right. We see that companies find it extremely hard to hold on to black people's talent. And you know, and we aren't seeing shifts on a lot of attitudes towards marginalized people, disabled people, people who identify as gay. I mean, with a lot of these things, we're making very little progress. And we're not going to change those numbers if we don't actually deal with the deep transformational stuff. So it's a bit of a paradox that. And then I also think that it touches on, again, the questions of the paradigms that we use in working with transformation. And I think we hold in tension, but they're not binaries, they're not stark differences, but there's sort of, if you think of it sort of as a continuum, on the one hand, there's sort of like very strongly reconciliation-oriented work, and on the other hand, there's very strongly social justice redress-oriented work. And I think that it's true that you know, through the period of transition, of necessity, if we were going to hold the nation together, we had to do a lot of work that put reconciliation as the sort of like the weight of our thinking and of our work towards reconciliation. But I think what is emerging is a recognition that we have to start pushing harder on the social justice side in the work that we're doing, pushing harder on the notions of redress, for example. Because it's clear that there are limitations, because because the work on reconciliation to the exclusion of the social justice work tends to favor the interests of the dominant group, of the people who are already in the places that already hold the goodies, as it were, the status quo. And if we're going to wait for those people, and I'm talking about all these intersections here, it's, you know, it's patriarchy, it's whiteness, it's heteronormativity, it's the ableist society. If we're going to wait for people in those powered, dominant positions to develop a sense that they have to give up and they have to change out of a sense of conscience and because this is the good, right thing to do, if we're wanting, you know, a better society, we're going to wait for a very, very long, long time. Because I think that what happens is that type of discourse tends to extract the capacity, the tools for people in subjugated positions to put pressure on dominant groups, because the pressure is on you to work with like a forgiveness paradigm rather than a rights-based paradigm. And unfortunately, it's in the nature of privilege. People who live in privileged positions, it's in the nature of that to foreclose one's insight into the social dynamics that create one's own privilege. That's what privilege does to one and for one, is that one tends not to understand the way in which social relations, economic relations, are actually skewed in your favor at the expense of other people, and you'd actually really seriously believe that you have what you have and you do what you do because of your merit and because in some ways you actually just have been a bit better and cleverer and you know that you actually really are entitled, and that in some ways any attempt to shift that confiscating something from you that is legitimately your entitlement. And so it's really, really hard for people in those dominant places to really shift without there being the sense of urgency that I talked about right at the beginning of my talk. Without there being real, genuine pressure, we slip into the sense of complacency. I just want to then just close by saying that, you know, I think that we have to really, really continue this work. We have to re-energize it. And we have to re-energize it in a way that we start asking really difficult questions of where we're at and making people understand the you know, bringing back that sense of urgency. And I think that it's really important that we develop in all our organizations and across our communities the sense of diversity literacy that makes us understand how these issues are all interrelated, how they're linked into questions of power, how our subjectivities are shaped within relations of unequal power, how our histories, are relevant in this day, that they're not questions of just the past, that they're present, they're not only in the present, they're in our future. Okay, so I'm going to stop because, I mean, there's a lot more I can say, but I think that we really need to re-energize this work, and it is a question largely of leadership. We need leaders who are going to put these issues firmly, squarely at the center of our organizational life, our community life, our national life, our public life. Thank you.
Thanks, Melissa. But let me, before I summarize some of the points that both speakers made, let me allow Bongani, who is Ndaba, who works with Nene, to give us his impressions of what he's seen in the work that they do. Thanks, Bongani.
Thank you. Many years ago, I went to a meeting, and I remember that meeting very clearly, that after the chairperson had closed the meeting, there was one person who insisted that he wanted to say the last word. And they stopped people and said, please just sit down and listen to the comrade, he was called. And the person said, I just want to support the last speaker. So basically, that's where it puts me.
Not at all.
Having supported the last speaker, I just want to, obviously, my panelists here, very grateful to Matthews and Dr. Bam. I always will never forget the opportunity that the IEC gave me many years ago. After all the voting rules were set and everything, we got a call almost 4 days before the elections that there are ministers who are concerned that they can't vote. They're not sure how to vote. And we ran a last-minute voter education for the ministers. And it was interesting to see they were just as concerned about getting it right as we were as South Africans. So that was, to me, very interesting. My focus really will be, I know that they've sketched the sort of landscape in the broader South Africa. I'll sort of confine myself to business. Having observed over many years of consulting in this era of diversity and inclusion, whether South African businesses have moved. For me, I always think to say that one has to acknowledge the work that has already gone into businesses. As we're sitting here, imagine an average of about 20 to 30 organizations are sitting in workshops in diversity and inclusion management. And therefore, it is ongoing work that is happening every day in businesses. But what are the challenges? If I look at what happened in 1994 or leading to 1994, is that the focus of diversity and inclusion was really on the rules of engagement. What does it mean to be polite? What does it mean if I respect your culture? And all those rules that everybody actually got right. And it began to evolve to say it does not end there. It has to go further to say, do we genuinely see each other as equals? Are we including everybody in this mainstream? And then it began now to evolve to saying, oh no, we thought we had it all right. Now you're starting another discussion and we're not up for this discussion. So when you look at South Africa, if you were to use the head, the heart, and the hands, is that the head understands diversity and inclusion issues very well. I don't think you can go to any workplace that deliberately does not comply to South African legislation in terms of treating everybody equally, treating everybody the same. But what is missing is the inclusion, where there's genuine buy-in in terms of diversity. Because once we buy in, it creates different actions and consistency in the actions. It makes other challenges like employment equity compliance easier. It makes it even easier how we treat one another in the communities. I don't know whether some of you have picked up that some people get shocked. You work in a particular organization, company, you are friends, you have a very good relationship with your colleagues, and you meet at the shopping mall. You look like you're strangers who've never known one another. And that is the challenge of having not internalized what you've learned in the workplace. So that's the challenge that really requires South Africans to begin to engage in. And these are harder discussions. Now, we, in terms of the process that we engage in working businesses, is that we, because in South Africa, what we lack, which is also alluded to by my, the other two speakers, that we don't have a benchmark that tells us clearly what does it mean to be a diverse and inclusive company. In America, they can pull all those tools. In South Africa, we don't yet have access to gathering the information. And therefore, organizations like ours rely largely in terms of sourcing that information from the clients that we have. So if I speak about whether South Africa has moved forward or not, you really rely on the information that you have access to in terms of the surveys you have, that you've conducted, the number of organizations and so forth. But what has been interesting for me is that even though diversity is broad, it's defined broad, it's also defined in our constitution, is that South Africa tends to narrow everything down to race. Two years ago, I listened on radio, John Robbie, talking about, you know, there was this program where you just phone in and he invited South Africa to just talk about anything. That was just before the World Cup. And he said, this time, please don't talk race. We've spoken a lot about race, so you can talk about anything, but not race. And the first caller, John Robbie then said, no, let's talk about dogs. You know, just walking the dogs in the park and out, what the dogs do and all of that. The first caller said, John, you know those white people, when they walk their dogs bark at black people. So you cannot even engage in a topic of talking about dogs without including race. We also have challenges of gender. You cannot talk about challenges of gender without saying who are advantaged in terms of employment equity. So you begin to look at it. Well, does gender mean women or does it mean white women? So everything we talk about would, in South Africa, invariably end talking about race. But race by its nature is uncomfortable. It is a topic. I've heard a lot of people who always say, I don't see color. And I say there's an opportunity for people to be trained and really, or maybe opticians have an opportunity here to just fix our eyesight and really make a lot of money out of that. Because we feel if I were to speak about race, it makes me somehow a bad person. It makes me someone who's fixated on issues of race, whilst we're actually not very comfortable about talking about those issues. I thought and said, if I were to sketch my own personal life around issues of diversity, I grew up and went to school in Natal. The only language I knew was isiZulu, and English was taught only for 30, 40 minutes. So my English was, good morning, goodbye, thank you very much. I was doing better. And then I went to work for a company which had moved from the Free State. And therefore, the employees that were brought in that company were 90% Sotho speaking. So in that, I became interested in Sotho. Sotho for me was like a foreign language. And after I learned it, it was amazing, the opportunity that it unlocked. Many years ago, I joined a company. I moved to another company. And part of what was called my growth and development was to send me to what was then called RAU. I'm imagining I'm at RAU now. And the program that I went through was called Redigering and Draaiboek. Now, that is the Afrikaans I can brag about. But then because of that opportunity I had, it gave me access to become what I would say I'm multilingual. Now, what did it do for me is that it enables me, when I do this work, to have access to a number of South Africans. Because now, not only do we talk concepts, I also talk to their hearts. I can also engage in their many languages. And once you begin to engage with people in their languages, then they begin to lower their guard, and then you begin to engage in the storytelling that the professor was talking about. The challenge, though, facing us, that there's a tendency to believe in South Africa that the younger generation is better off than the old generation. Many years ago, I was fortunate to be part of the task team that investigated racism at Freiburg High School. part of that investigation was to do a sort of audit or analysis of what was in the minds of the young children to be able to engage in that sort of action. And we interviewed youngsters at that time. It was called Standard 6, I think grade 8 nowadays. And the language that came from those grade 8s, who should now, they should be about 30 years old now as we speak, are the people that are in business today. So what does it mean? It really means we shouldn't give young people too much credit in terms of how we've moved and the lessons that they've learned from the environments that they come from. That the baggage is still alive, and it is the baggage that we need to be engaging in terms of determining this kind of work. Now, diversity work in South Africa, most of the times, is shaped by different events. If you look at 1994, diversity work after the new democracy, Mandela became president, there was the Rainbow Nation, our Archbishop Desmond Tutu spoke about the Rainbow Nation. What began to happen in business in terms of diversity and inclusion, as well as compliance and really bringing on people who were excluded, was that businesses went back. Change went back. Nobody said, yeah, let's grab this opportunity. Let's move it forward. And then came 1998 and the introduction of the employment equity legislation. And the employment equity legislation began to sort of give direction in terms of saying, how do we need to transform? Now again, it was mainly how do we get good lawyers who can write very good plans so that we do bare minimum and then we please the Department of Labor. And as we evolve now, and people sort of, many businesses saying that the Department of Labor doesn't have the skills to monitor compliance to employment equity, you can see with the latest reports now that it shows that we've actually gone back again. So for me, the missing link that still sees a lot of work that has to be done is how do we internalize this, that over and above legislation should be just our guide, and that we really feel and mean that this is the right thing to do. Therefore, I believe, like the other panelists have said, that we need to intensify interventions around diversity and inclusion. We should not assume that South Africa, as we are like the Rainbow Nation as a vision, because a vision says we haven't yet arrived. And I will leave it here.